Good morning. Thank you, Mitch. Wonderful course, Amy and Doug. Thanks for the invitation. So this is the outline. We'll talk some on the background and some definitions which are very important to know the differences in different phenotypes. We'll touch on risk factors, some clues about when to consider a liver biopsy, and with treatment and some cardiovascular risks, and I'll give some pearls about take-home messages. Let's start with a vignette. You probably have heard my story about Rob at my other talks before, but bear with me. Rob is now 42 years old, is overweight, and is Caucasian. His BMI is listed here, is about 29 kgs per meter square. Drinks socially 1 to 2 times per week. And he has dyslipidemia. His LDL is 160. His fasting glucose is 113. It's glucose intolerant. And ALT is increased 90 international units per liter. We've done a viral hepatitis screen. It is negative. And the serum ferritin was about 450 nanograms per ml, slightly high. So as you are seeing Rob in your practice, some of the questions that come to you, does he have NAFLD? Should he be concerned? How should he be worked up? Should he be told to stop drinking completely? When do you need to send him to a GI? Does he need a liver biopsy? And he has dyslipidemia. Is it safe to give statins? Starting with background, NAFLD is a big deal, and it is continuing to grow. It's in the liver disease realm, it is the reached the epidemic proportions. It's about if the prevalence of NAFLD depends on how you're looking for it. If you screen population using ALT, it's about 7 to 10% of US adults. However, if you use more sophisticated tests such as the MRI, it can be as much as 35% of US adults. And it is the most common cause of liver disease in liver clinics. It is the most common cause of cirrhosis, and by 2020, it is going to be the most common cause why patients are listed for liver transplantation. So it's a massive problem, and we are going to see more of it. A really important slide. Now, there seems to be a lot of confusion about the terminology. Keep in mind that NAFLD is an umbrella description of entire syndrome. It has two sub-phenotypes. One is NAFL, also called simple fatty liver. Here, when you do a liver biopsy, all that you're seeing is fat accumulation, macrovesicular steatosis, with some inflammation at the most, but you do not have ballooned hepatocytes, or you do not have any fibrosis. Generally speaking, if you do a liver biopsy, all that you're seeing is simple fatty liver. From a liver standpoint, it tends to do quite well from a prognosis standpoint. Whereas non-alcoholic steatohepatitis is more a severe phenotype of NAFLD. Here, in addition to fatty liver, you have inflammation, ballooning, and fibrosis. What defines steatohepatitis is the ballooned hepatocyte, basically an enlarged hepatocyte that's dying because of cell injury. And that seems to be the one that drives fibrosis, and patients with NASH are at risk for progressive disease, cirrhosis, liver cancer, and of course, need for liver transplantation. What are the risk factors for NAFLD? I have two columns here. Most of you know what the major comorbidities like diabetes, dyslipidemia, obesity, and metabolic syndrome. And we look for them in our practice, but I draw your attention to some of the rarer ones. What I describe them as emerging associations, hypothyroidism, very frequent if you look in your patient population with NAFLD, sleep apnea, some of the hormonal disorders like polycystic ovary syndrome, hypopituitarism, hypogonadism, and even pancreatic resection. And you may rarely see somebody who is in mid-20s with advanced NASH and fibrosis. That is typically the patient who has had neonatal hypothyroidism or has had cranial irradiation for craniopharyngioma now has growth hormone deficiency. So some of those patients can be treated while the disease can be stabilized, even be reversed. We already touched on the outcomes of NAFLD. If you have fatty liver, from a liver standpoint, risk of cirrhosis over the course of next 25 years is quite good, and it's under 5%. Whereas if the biopsy shows non-alcoholic steatohepatitis with or without fibrosis, the risk of cirrhosis is about 10% per over a 10-year time horizon, and it can the risk continues to grow with time. And NASH cirrhosis seems to behave better than Hep C cirrhosis, but the data are old. This was prior to direct-acting antivirals. But the NASH cirrhosis is going to become an important cause for liver cancer over the course of next decade or so. I think, as I touched on, patients with NASH have increased liver complications. But to draw your attention, patients with NASH also have an increased risk of diabetes. If your patient with NAFLD is not a diabetic, the chances of he or she becoming diabetic in the next 5 years is quite high. And then also not well recognized is the risk of cardiovascular disease. For patients with NAFLD and NASH, the most common cause of death is cardiovascular disease by far. So although as gastroenterologists we may be focused on liver health, I think we should be very concerned about their cardiovascular risk, stopping smoking and other things. We want to pay particular attention to their cardiovascular risk modification. How do you work up? You know, I think everybody with NAFLD needs imaging. You need to get meticulous alcohol and medication history. Many times patients don't report their alcohol history sufficiently in the first interview. So once you get to know them, you may get more details. So some of the patients that were sent to us for clinical trials says NASH, turning out to be it's a combination of the NASH plus fair amount of alcohol as well. And the medications, though, I think we have studied drugs like amiodarone and methotrexate. But today, though, tamoxifen is the very important cause of fatty liver, especially with newer guidelines requiring some of the patients with breast cancer may take tamoxifen for about 10 years. They could be rapid progression of the disease, and even over a 5 to 10 year horizon, you can end up with advanced fibrosis with tamoxifen. Important to exclude coexisting or competing etiologies, whether somebody has hemochromatosis, alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency, so on and so forth. Be aware, patients with NAFLD, many of them have low titer autoantibodies. Don't freak out. May consider a liver biopsy, but do not give them steroids unless it is clear-cut autoimmune hepatitis. You may even see ANA in 1 in 160 dilutions. And also increased ferritin is not uncommon, as our index patient had. It's just a reflection of insulin resistance. You may want to get HFE gene analyses and occasionally phlebotomy, but the data suggests that the phlebotomies don't change the natural history of NAFLD. And today, a couple problems, though, is liver enzymes can be completely normal even in patients with NASH. That is trumps all of us in the clinic, and today only liver biopsy can distinguish whether a patient has fatty liver or has our NASH. And that's a problem because you cannot go on doing liver biopsies in about a third of US adults. So there's been a lot of interest in coming up with surrogate markers non-invasively to identify who may have either advanced fibrosis or non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. There's a table here. This is 5 years old, and if you do a literature search, there are more than 500 such studies in this area. I'll touch on a few interesting and important non-invasive tests that have made it to the practice guidelines. So there are a couple risk stratification models. One is called FIB-4. The other one is called NAFLD Fibrosis Score. There are web-based calculators. You can easily search FIB-4 and it'll come up, and you can put in some of the bedside variables to know whether your patient is at a high risk or low risk for fibrosis. And then also there are blood-based keratin 18 as well as ELF. They're not approved in the United States. And there's a lot of interest about imaging-based transient elastography. That's the FibroScan and MRI. This is Fib4 based on AST, ALT, age, and platelet count. Actually, some of the early work was done at VCU where Dr. Schiffman was, and can really tell your, you know, sort of triaging whether to consider a biopsy in your patient if the score is high, or if the score is low, you can say you don't need a liver biopsy. And then the same thing, you can use NAFLD fibrosis score. Once again, there is a web-based calculator. You can plug it in, and this is from Mayo Clinic, widely used. You can choose one or the other. I tend to use Fib4 in my clinical practice. Once again, these are sort of a poor man's test to guide you in terms of which patient needs a liver biopsy. This is the big story in the last 2 years, at least at our medical center, and I suspect many of your practices as well. FibroScan now approved by the United States FDA for testing for advanced fibrosis. It's vibration-controlled transient elastography. Today, the machines have two probes, M probe and XL probe, and then also in addition to liver stiffness, it also can give you what's called a CAP score, a continuous attenuation parameter. And the liver stiffness is measuring, is a surrogate for fibrosis, whereas CAP is a surrogate for quantity of hepatic fat. And there are, as I said, there's a small probe, medium and XL probe. For some of you who have read in the literature that the FibroScan failure rate in NAFLD is high, 20-30%, that's using the medium probe. Now the machine is smart. It's almost like FibroScan for dummies. It tells you, you start with an M probe in an NAFLD patient, it says, no, go to XL. Or if you start with an XL, it says, you know, you can start with an M probe. So a machine-derived protocol between M and XL protocol probes, the failure rate is under 5%. And the NASH Clinical Research Network has experience in about 2,000 procedures and really performs quite well with a very minimal variability. The optimal cutoff values for liver stiffness are not very clear. I'm just throwing some numbers that, based on our experience, if you do a FibroScan, if the liver stiffness is under 7 or 7.5 kilopascals, you can tell the patient the odds of significant fibrosis is minimal. But if you have gotten into double digits, especially 20s, I think it's a really important fibrotic disease. When to do biopsy, we touched on this. When you think if your patient has likely to have NASH or fibrosis, that's the patient you want to subject to liver biopsy. Or if you cannot exclude competing etiologies, for example, high autoimmune markers, high ferritin, or there is tamoxifen use, those are the rare special circumstances where you want to do a liver biopsy. The treatment, this is exploded in the last 5 years. 5 years ago, if you had done a search on clinicaltrials.gov, there would probably be four or five studies. The last time I checked, there are about 250 clinical trials registered for NASH at the clinicaltrials.gov. Here we go. So there are weight loss, TZDs, and vitamin E, they work. Ursodeoxycholic acid, metformin, and milk thistle have been tested for NAFLD in clinical trials. They do not work, so don't use them for NASH. There's a lot of excitement about phase 3 trials, obeticholic acid, elafibranor, that's the GenFit compound, and liraglutide. They all are starting phase 3, and maybe the Tobira compound is going to start the phase 3 program as well. And there are a number of phase 1 and phase 2 trials upcoming. Weight loss, if your patients can achieve it, it's going to take care of NASH tremendously. So, but there are no data about types of diet. But we do know if you lose 7 to 10%, in addition to fat, even the inflammation, the resolution of steatohepatitis and fibrosis improves. And this is a beautiful study published by Villar Gomez from Havana. He had done serial biopsies in about 300 patients with NASH, biopsy-proven NASH. They were in a lifestyle modification protocol. What I want to draw your attention to is there is a dose-dependent relationship between the degree of weight loss and histological improvement. For example, somebody who lost 10% of the body weight, look at the resolution of steatohepatitis, 90%. NAFLD activity score improved 100%. In about 45%, there is an improvement in fibrosis as well. But only 10% of the patients were able to achieve that threshold of weight loss. So the bottom line, if you have a motivated patient, that's always the first approach to go, and then give them a goal about 7 to 10% over the course of a year. Bariatric surgery can be effective, and it can, depending on the length of follow-up, it can even improve fibrosis. Fat resolves quite quickly. This is from Samir Matar when he was at Pittsburgh, showing the fat resolve really within first 8 months or so. And this is very interesting. This is a series from Montreal showing even the cirrhosis over the course of 10-year period. NASH cirrhotics had a biliary pancreatic diversion type of bariatric surgery. 10 years later, their cirrhosis reversed. So a profound, significant weight loss that is sustained even in advanced cirrhotics can lead to tremendous histological benefit. TZDs, we spent about a decade, they work. The problem with the TZDs is that they have the bad news, or at least the rap about the bad news of heart failure, and increased cardiovascular mortality, bone loss, so on and so forth. So they're not used very much. The PIVENS trial, the one we were part of, very interesting. It tested both vitamin E as well as pioglitazone. In this trial that was published in New England Journal of Medicine, vitamin E had about a 45% response compared to placebo. Numbers needed to treat was about 4.5. And the only concern, this was a high-dose vitamin E, the only concern is high-dose vitamin E in elderly population may lead to increased risk of prostate cancer. So if you're going to use vitamin E, it needs to be in biopsy-proven patients with NASH, and you may want to discuss about the rare risk of prostate cancer. I'm going to skip that. Last few minutes, the FXR agonist, this is the obeticholic acid, this is the Lancet paper that we were part of. Took the novel therapeutics of NASH by storm, and this is an FXR agonist. I'm just going to flip here. It showed the obeticholic acid over the course of 72 weeks has shown significantly higher response rate compared to placebo. Now this company is doing a phase 3 trial. FXR, this agonist is approved for PBC, but it is not at all appropriate to use obeticholic acid off-label for NASH. The reason for that is there are some issues with dyslipidemia as well as itching. Until those things are sorted out, I don't think this compound should be used for NASH yet. I'm going to skip this. As I touched, cardiovascular disease is a big deal in this patient population, so your attention should be directed at minimizing cardiovascular risk. I routinely take the smoking history and I tell patients to stop smoking, and I get them on a treadmill. And actually, you know, 15 years or so, we've been following some of these patients. The events that you see are more cardiovascular. They come back with stents rather than hepatocellular carcinoma as much. Statins can be used quite safely in this patient population. And this is now old news. Only thing now I want to suggest is statins, even in cirrhotics, is perfectly fine to use, but when somebody gets to a decompensated state with ascites, please stop the steroid statins. At that stage, the risk of rhabdomyolysis goes up. So to sum up, take-home messages. When you have a patient with NAFLD, exclude competing etiologies. Please pay attention to drugs such as tamoxifen. NASH is progressive, can lead to cirrhosis and liver failure. And then I cannot emphasize enough about the risk of cardiovascular disease in these patients. And I think if you pay attention to that, I think you are helping your patients quite immensely. Today, liver biopsy is the only modality that distinguishes fatty liver from NASH. But there's a lot of activity in non-invasive testing. And hopefully, next few years, there will be a clear roadmap in terms of which patients to get liver biopsy and who can be followed non-invasively. Thank you for your attention.